Well, happy Easter, everybody. Thanks for coming out this weekend. I want you to know that this is one of those open door kind of places where everyone's welcome, whether you're a longtime believer in Jesus Christ or whether you're just kind of curious about who he was and what he does and what it means to really walk with God. We are so, so glad that you're here today. And God is even more stoked that you're here because he'll meet you right where you're at. Here today. Well, I'm sure that all of you can remember. I know that all of you can remember the 1969 Cubs who won it all. I'm not talking about those Cubs. I'm talking about the 1969 champions of the Southern Little League Cubs. Those Cubs. The undefeated Cubs. The 16-0 Cubs. We got huge trophies and snow cones and pixie sticks and all the double bubble we could chew. It was awesome. I'll never, ever forget being on that championship team. That's a big deal for a 12-year-old boy. You got any great memories you remember? Any great victories you remember? You ever been on a championship team? You ever won anything? You ever won like an office pool at work or... Maybe you won some concert tickets when you called in a radio show, or maybe you held a winning lottery ticket, or you won a bowling tournament, or you won a fishing tournament, or a beauty contest, or a spelling bee, or a talent show, or maybe you won an argument with your wife once. As a sports fan, I just love this time of year, because this time of year you got March Madness, the Masters Golf Tournament, the NBA playoffs, the start of the Major League Baseball season, all happen at the same time. And along the way, individuals and teams get to celebrate victories together. But here's the thing. We don't have an annual day set aside to commemorate and celebrate any of those victories. I mean, next year, we will not take time off and celebrate UConn's victory over Butler in the ugliest game in the history of NCAA finals. In fact, in a few years, almost everyone who is not a Packers fan, and that's almost everyone, won't even remember who won the Super Bowl. Okay, Sun Prairie campus, you can boo me now. But seriously, more people will remember the commercials than who won the game. I can remember this scene from a movie. I don't know the name of the movie. I just caught it on an airplane one time. But it was about a high school basketball coach who takes over a tough bunch of kids from a tough school, kind of an inner city type school, and he gathers his players on the bleachers in the gym, and he asks them, "So what's your goal in life?" And one of them says, "Win state, coach." Another one says, "Yeah, win state." And they all kind of chime in, "Yeah, win state." And he says, "Okay, who won state last year?" And nobody could remember. He says, "So you want your goal in life to be something that no one will remember a year from now." You see, some victories are just quickly forgotten. But not this one. Not this one. This weekend, millions of people all over the globe are gathering in stone cathedrals and mud huts and rented movie theaters and living rooms and old malls in Rockford and office parks in Sun Prairie. Some are even huddled secretly in countries where following Jesus can get you in major trouble, all just to celebrate this victory. You see, this is a seriously huge victory. This is a big time victory with incredible possibilities for everybody. This is the greatest victory of all time. It's the ultimate victory. It's the one that we Christ followers celebrate every single year. Well, actually, every single week. Well, actually, every single day. Because I'm not overstating this, it's a life-changing kind of victory. It's changed many of your lives. Well, it changed their lives as well. I want to read from the Gospel of Matthew the story of that first Easter. He says, "After the Sabbath, at dawn, on the first day of the week, Mary Magdalene and the other Mary went to look at the tomb. There was a violent earthquake, for an angel of the Lord came down from heaven and, going to the tomb, rolled back the stone and sat on it. His appearance was like lightning, and his clothes were white as snow. The guards were so afraid of him that they shook and became like dead men. The angel said to the women, "Do not be afraid." Right. You know, we tend to think of angels like little cute cherub-like creatures, you know. But almost every time they show up in Scripture, the first words out of their mouth is, "Don't be afraid." He says, "Don't be afraid. I know that you're looking for Jesus, who was crucified. But he's not here. He has risen, just as he said. Come, see the place where he lay. Then go quickly and tell his disciples. He has risen from the dead, and he's going ahead of you into Galilee. There you will see him." Now, I've told you. It says, so the women hurried away from the tomb, afraid, yet filled with joy, and ran to tell his disciples. Suddenly, Jesus met them. "Greetings," he said. John's account says that they thought at first it was the gardener who worked in the graveyard there, but they realized it was Jesus alive in front of him. It says they came to him, clasped his feet, and worshiped him. And Jesus said to them, "Don't be afraid. Go and tell my brothers to go to Galilee, and there they will see me." There you have it. The greatest victory of all time. See, one of the things we learn early on in life is that death is so final, right? I remember one Easter we got our kids this little duckling, cute little duckling, and our precious daughter Jody was walking through the backyard hugging that little duckling. The only problem was she loved it so much and hugged it so tightly that, well, it went to heaven at a very young age, which led to all kinds of questions about ducks and goldfish and turtles and dogs and heaven. But we all of us knew, including our kids, that that duck was not going to come waddling around the yard anytime soon. Well, we all learned early on that death is just one of those things that is, well, irreversible. And you know, maybe for you it wasn't something like a duckling you lost as a kid. Maybe someone you loved very, very deeply died. And you could sense, even as a child, that they weren't coming back around anytime soon. But just think about it for a second with me. What would it mean for us if what we just read was really true? You see, Easter holds out the awesome promise of reversibility. It shouts, nothing, not even death is final. Even that can be reversed. Just put yourself in their shoes just for a minute. Imagine yourself in that scene on that Sunday morning. And think about someone that you love, someone who's passed away. Think about when they passed away, how deeply you grieve when they die. Think about how much they meant to you and how much you miss them. And now just imagine walking out in the parking lot after the service. And there they are, right there, standing there in front of you, alive. Same twinkle in their eye, same unique smile. Would that blow you away or what? Well, that's what happened to them. That's the kind of joy they experienced on that first Easter. Friday night, they were completely devastated. The best person they had ever met, the one who held the words of life, the one in whom they placed all their hopes and dreams, had died on a Roman cross. They were there. They watched him die. They watched him as he was unjustly crucified as a common criminal. And all kinds of emotions were running through them. Grief and deep sadness and anger over all the injustice of it and disillusionment and hopelessness. Plus, they just missed him. They loved him. But on that Sunday morning, man, they heard a brand new note of hope and faith ringing out. They saw with their own eyes their friend, their Savior, their Lord, standing right there in front of them. They saw with their own eyes that what God did in a graveyard outside Jerusalem, that he could and would repeat on a grander scale for them, for you, for me, for your family, for my family, for anyone who would choose to believe. You see, the message of Easter is that against all odds, the irreversible can be reversed. You know, sometimes we get to thinking that our past is irreversible. You and I start thinking, man, whew, this could never be erased. This will never be forgotten. This could never be forgiven. I will never recover from this. Easter says, think again. Think again. Nothing is irreversible. Oh, there still may be consequences and fallout from what you've done or what happened, but life can be so much different from this point on. The irreversible can be reversed. You know, a couple of weeks ago, we talked about one of Jesus' closest friends, a guy named Peter, who had made some pretty boastful claims about his loyalty to Jesus. You know, kind of thumped his chest up in the upper room, sat in front of all the other guys. Hey, the rest of these guys may fall away, but I would never betray you. I would die for you. And you remember how just a few hours later, in a darkly lit courtyard, when he had a chance to take a simple stand of friendship, he denies ever even meeting Jesus before. And a rooster crows, and he runs out of the courtyard, he falls to a heap of regret and remorse, and he cries like a baby over his inability to stand up for his friend. Now I want you to see Mark's account of the resurrection story, because this, to me, is so cool. Most scholars believe that Mark was guided as he wrote his gospel, of course, by God's Spirit, but also with the help of Peter. Mark's gospel is kind of like the memoirs of Peter. So this really kind of choked me up this week when I read it again. Look what it says in Mark 16. The angel says this: don't be alarmed. You're looking for Jesus the Nazarene who was crucified. He is risen. He's not here. See the place where they laid him. But go. Tell his disciples and Peter, he's going ahead of you into Galilee. There you will see him, just as he told you. Did you catch that? Go tell his disciples and Peter. Isn't that cool? He's just saying, make sure you tell Peter, especially Peter. Because if anybody needs to know that the irreversible can be reversed, it's him. So please, make sure you tell Peter, because the guy is just drowning in grief. He is so disappointed in himself. He is full of self-doubt and shame. He's thinking, oh man, what kind of man does what I did? Who brags about his loyalty to his friend and shrinks back when he has a chance to take a stand? What kind of friend, what kind of man, what kind of human being actually does that? So go tell his disciples and Peter that the irreversible can be reversed. Anybody here need to hear that about your past? Anybody here feel hopeless because you failed at your job, you failed at your marriage, you failed sexually, you failed financially, you failed to tell the truth, you failed as a parent, or maybe you failed your parents? You ever been halfway through a project and you just want to start over? Ever been halfway through a school year and you just want to start over? Halfway through a career and you want to start over? Halfway through a relationship and you want to start over? Halfway through a life, you just want to start over? Well, I'm glad you're here. Because the message of the empty tomb is that through Jesus Christ, you can. You can say, I'm going to start over. My failure is not final. My past is going to be reversed. With God's help, I am going to do a 180. You see, with those two words, and Peter, it totally changed his life. He picked himself up. You can read all about it in John chapter 21, how he comes face to face, kind of gets one-on-one with the risen Jesus, and he learns that God wants to use his life to change the world. Jesus tells him, Peter, you are loved. You are useful. Your past is past. Peter, look at me. I was dead. Now I'm alive. See my scars? What you thought was irreversible can be reversed. And I would just kind of go out on a limb today. Actually, it's a pretty short limb. And say, there's no accident that God brought you here today. I believe that God brought some of you here so he could get one-on-one with you and tell you that there's nothing you have ever done beyond his love. As low as you think you have gone, his grace reaches lower. As far as you can run away, he runs further. Your failure is not final. What you think is irreversible can be reversed. Listen, if God can blow the rock off a tomb and give life back to a dead man, he can give your life back as well. That's the message of Easter. It's just one of the reasons I think it's by far the greatest victory of all time. Now, I say just one of the reasons because it doesn't just have the potential to change your past. It can change how you view your current situation. You see, if you choose to walk with that God, if you choose to embrace the one who came back from the dead, can you imagine the kind of power you would have to face head on the stuff that you have to face every day? Now, Ephesians chapter 1, verse 19, 20 is a verse that we've seen often around here, and I'm not sure we can be reminded of it enough, but I want to read it again. Look what it says. I also pray that you will understand the incredible greatness of God's power for us who believe Him. This is the same mighty power that raised Christ from the dead and seated Him in the place of honor at God's right hand in the heavenly realms. Again, that's the message of Easter. The things going on in your life right now that you think are irreversible really aren't. You have a power source to help you face them head on and get through. I mean, life's hard, isn't it? I mean, Jesus told us it would be. And He experienced a tough life. I mean, honestly, things go wrong. And we lose jobs. And kids get in trouble. And houses won't sell. And bills go unpaid. And wombs stay empty. And parents get cancer. And bodies fall apart. It's the reality of life on this planet. And for some of us, right now, it's our current reality. But some of you, you're at a crossroad in your life. Some of you are going through one of those things they call like midlife crisis. You know what I'm talking about? You look in the mirror and you don't recognize that person looking back at you. And you go, man, where did the time go? And then you begin to realize that you're about halfway through. And if there's a middle, there has to be an end. And you're wondering, man, what difference am I really making? Does my life even matter? You know, some of you right now, you're right in that spot where you're raising kids, and you are scared to death. You think about your precious little girl, your precious little boy growing up in this world full of terrorism and gangs and drugs and Amber Alerts, and you think about all the school bullies out there and the unhealthy obsession with body image and those snobby little cliques that your kids are going to experience, and you just don't want to see them get hurt. And you as a parent right now feel so inadequate to prepare them for life. Some of you, like never before, are losing sleep and you're popping Tums, maybe even worse, because of your financial picture. You never thought it would take this long to find a job. You never dreamed that your house would be worth half as much as you owe. And stress and worry and anxiety is just eating you at lunch. But listen to me. It doesn't have to. Sure, it's hard, but I'm telling you from experience, it's so much better when you hang on to the one who stared death in the face and said, not today, not ever. See, after the death of Jesus, the disciples were facing some major problems. They were scared to death. They were hiding out. They were playing that what-if game. You ever play that game, the what-if game, where you're consumed by what might happen? You know, you're a college student heading back to school. You're thinking, oh, what if their car breaks down? The whole time they're driving, you're thinking that. Or you're on a date, and you go, what if my breath is bad? Or what if I get a huge zit in the middle of my forehead? What if they think I'm a cyclops? You know, what if, what if, what if? You stress out about what might happen. Well, these guys are behind closed doors. They're playing that what-if game. They're thinking, what if the religious leaders decide, like, to come after us? I mean, what if we get implicated in Jesus' charge of treason and Rome wants to put us on a cross too? I mean, what if our jobs that we left to follow Jesus are no longer waiting for us back home? What if we can never show our face again because our friends and our family think we're so stupid to give up the last 3 years of our life to follow this guy? What if? What if? What if? Well, check this out. John chapter 20. Verse 19 and 20. That Sunday evening, the disciples were meeting behind locked doors because they were afraid of the Jewish leaders. Suddenly, Jesus was standing there among them. Peace be with you, He said. As He spoke, He showed them the wounds in His hands and His side. And they were filled with joy when they saw the Lord. So what if He's alive? You know what I think is really cool about those two verses? is the immediate change. The immediate change in the current situation of those disciples. I mean, one minute they're afraid, the next minute they're at peace, one minute they're filled with despair, the next minute they're filled with joy, one minute they're crushed, the next minute they're confident, one minute they're totally defeated, the next they're dynamic. Immediate change. There was nothing now that could happen in their life that they knew they couldn't face, because the God of get up from the dead power was standing right in front of them. And he promised to never leave them, to never forsake them. Can you maybe see why doing life with that God could make a difference in the way you approach your current situation? And some of you are saying, yeah, bro, you don't know, man. You just don't know. You don't know how bad my finances are. God does. You don't know how my marriage is just hanging on by a thread. God does. Yeah, bro, you have no idea. You've never been there. You have no idea how hard it is to kick this addiction. And God does. And the God of the universe, he stands ready to extend to you the same kind of power that raised Jesus Christ from the dead to help you face whatever you're facing right now. What you think is irreversible can be reversed. That's Easter's message. That your past and your current situation and your future, all of it, can be reversed. I mean, let's get honest first. We all get stressed out a little bit about dying, right? I mean, all of us are a little afraid about death. And I think there's, reasons. We're afraid of the fear. We have the fear of the unknown, right? There's that fear of separation from people that we love. There's the fear of just the physical pain of death, the sickness. We wonder how we're going to go out. Are we going to go out in a hospice? Are we going to go out in a nursing home? Are we going to go down on a plane? Are we going to crash in a car, on a roller coaster, whatever, fall in a pit of rattlesnakes? It's a recurring nightmare that I have. But death can be a little freaky, right? It can be a little scary. Death is such an enemy of life. A group of little kids were asked to write what they believed about death. Gilda, age 8, wrote these words. When you die, they put you in a box and bury you in the ground because you don't look so good. Stephanie, age 9, wrote this. I love this. Doctors help you so you won't die until you pay their bill. A smart little girl right there. Marcia, age 9, wrote this. When you die, you don't have to do homework in heaven unless your teacher's there. I think I may have told you before about a t-shirt I saw a college student wearing one day. He's walking across campus toward me, and on the front of the t-shirt, a bright yellow t-shirt, big bold black letters said, live. And on the back of it, it said, die. I thought, that's a weird t-shirt. So I kind of got back in front of him and kind of looked again, see the writing underneath of it. It said, live like you'll die tomorrow. Die knowing you'll live forever. You see, when you're not afraid to die, you're not afraid to live. Man, does it make a difference when you know that your future, which all of us are going to experience, can be reversed. It makes a huge difference in the way you approach every single day. I love the words of 2 Timothy chapter 1, verse 10. It says this about the victory that we're celebrating here today. It says, now Christ Jesus has come to show us the what? The kindness of God. Remember, God so loved the world that he gave his son. Not God was so ticked at the world that he had to do something. Jesus has come to show us the kindness of God. Christ our Savior defeated death and brought us the good news. And it shines like a light and offers life that never ends. He defeated death and offers life that never ends. There's another scripture that I just love. It's one of those that resonates in my heart. It was written by that and Peter guy. And look what Peter writes. He says, praise be to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. In his great mercy, he has given us new birth into a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. He calls what we now have a living hope. a forever kind of hope that translates into a right now, today, in the middle of tough stuff kind of hope. Now, I like the way the Message puts this entire passage in 1 Peter chapter 3, 3 through 9. Look what it says, kind of a lengthy passage, but just track with me. It says this: what a God we have, and how fortunate we are to have Him, this Father of our Master Jesus. Because Jesus was raised from the dead, we've been given a brand new life, and we have everything to live for, including a future in heaven. And the future starts now. God is keeping careful watch over us and the future. The day is coming when you'll have it all, life healed and whole. Then He says, I know how great this makes you feel. Even though right now, you have to put up with every kind of aggravation in the meantime. Pure gold put into the fire comes out of it proved pure. Genuine faith put through this kind of suffering, it comes out proved genuine. When Jesus wraps this all up, it's your faith, not your gold, that God will have on display as evidence of His victory. And then Peter says this: you never saw Him like I did, yet you still love Him. And you still don't see Him, but you trust Him with laughter and singing. Because you kept on believing, you'll get what you're looking forward to. Total salvation. Isn't that a cool passage? And Peter wrote that. He says, I've seen the resurrected Jesus. I've touched Him. He's got your future. Death is not final. It is not irreversible. Now, it's been said that possums are pretty smart animals. Now, you wouldn't know it by the numbers of them found in the middle of the road, but a possum, I don't know if you know this, a little Kentucky folk over here, a possum will not enter a hole in the ground if he sees only one set of tracks leading into that hole. Because he knows with only one set of tracks that there's another animal waiting in that hole to destroy it. But if he sees two sets of tracks, one leading in and one leading out, he'll go in and not be afraid. There are two sets of tracks at the empty tomb. Tracks leading in and tracks leading out. We don't have to be afraid to face death. It's been defeated. I told you, the ultimate victory. And you know what? With every sports victory, there's a fair amount of trash talk. You know what I'm talking about? A little bit of taunting, little trash talk. I love this verse of Scripture. I love that trash talk is in the Bible. 1 Corinthians chapter 15. Look what it says. Where, O death, is your victory? Where, O death, is your sting? That all you got? That's kind of what it's saying, right? Isn't that cool? He says, thanks be to God who gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. You see, Easter proves that nothing is irreversible. Not your past, not your present situation, not the future that awaits us all down the road. You know, one of the things I love about this place is that all of us come from so many different backgrounds. I mean, we're different ages, we're different sizes and shapes, we come from different families, different nationalities, different ethnicities, but the one thing we have in common is that all of us are travelers, and we're all on a journey, we are all on a road. And you know as well as I do, sometimes our road is smooth and occasionally breathtakingly scenic. Other times it's filled with crater-sized potholes, right? And sometimes we find ourselves on a certain road, totally unexpected. And then there are other times we look down the road that we know we have to travel and our stomach gets all in knots. Sometimes the road that we're on, it's long and it's winding, and other times the road just comes to an abrupt dead end. And sometimes you and I do a great job of navigating the journey, and oftentimes we make a wrong turn and find ourselves in need of recalculating. But all of us are travelers. We're all on a journey. We all have a road. And over the past few weeks, we've seen that Jesus had one too. And much like ours, His road brought Him lots of joy and laughter along the way, but also plenty of challenges and curves. And Jesus met all kinds of people on the road. I mean, all kinds. And you know what? He noticed them all. And He touched them all. He loved them all. And he died for them all. See, Jesus never saw people as being in the way of where he wanted to go. People were his road. You were his destination. He had come to travel a road that nobody else could travel. A road that would bring people back to God. A road that would lead to the redemption of all of mankind. And only he could walk that road. And because of love, he chose to go down. So today, we gather to celebrate that choice. We come together to celebrate that victory, the greatest victory of all time. Today, we embrace that amazing love with thankful hearts. And today, we follow his tracks on a road that leads away from an empty tomb. A road that leads to eternal life. A road that all of us can walk. A road that he invites every single one of us to walk. Today, right now, and forever. So let's stand up and let's celebrate the greatest victory of all time.